I think we're talking about very, very different phenomena that are both repetitive. So as Christian's slide nicely illustrated, you can look at the topography of it and see these things are alike. But when you look more at the function of the behavior, I think that they're very different. So again, let's go back to our essential features of OCD. We're talking about these unwanted obsessional thoughts, these compulsive behaviors. And in OCD, the compulsions, again, I think I've said this a few times, are performed to reduce anxiety. But it's not just compulsions that are performed to reduce anxiety. People who have OCD actually use a range of different strategies to reduce their anxiety in response to obsessions. They might avoid situations, right? People who have contamination fears, they'll avoid going to the bathroom. They might avoid shaking your hand if they wonder if you've washed your hands recently. They might use mental rituals, right? So things that they're doing in their mind, like praying over and over again 10 times to be sure that they're not going to go to hell. Thought suppression, so, you know, don't think about, you know, having sex with my child. Don't think about it. Asking for reassurances, asking other people questions over and over again. Covert, or what we call mini rituals. So things like if I'm driving down the street and I have an obsession about hitting the person jogging on the side of the road, I'm gonna grab the steering wheel really tight as I drive by to prevent me from doing something catastrophic, like acting on my unwanted thought. Or covert mental strategies. While I'm reading a book and I see the word death, I might substitute the word life as I come to that word, because death is an unacceptable thing to think about. But it's that in OCD, these compulsive rituals, washing the hands over and over again, going back to check over and over again, these more covert behaviors, that's what kind of stands out, right? That's what's kind of the most observable symptom. And I think that that's why compulsions, and you don't hear about these other covert strategies, they haven't made it into the DSM. They're not described in DSM. Compulsions have. And so, I think that's a problem with DSM, and that we're focusing too much on topography and on the overt symptoms rather than really understanding the behavior and actually what's going on behaviorally. Not only that, but I think that, so I've made the case hopefully that OCD there's not this spectrum. These other disorders are not related to OCD. But what about returning to the question, is OCD an anxiety disorder? Well, first of all, obsessions provoke fear in the same way that a phobic situation would provoke fear, in the same way as being worried about a social situation. Speaking in front of a large group of people might provoke fear for someone with social phobia. And as Christian mentioned, I do think that in OCD, it's these intrusive, unwanted thoughts that are the feared stimuli. Compulsive rituals and these other escape behaviors serve the same function as other behaviors that we see in anxiety disorders whenever we meet someone with an anxiety disorder. People with panic and agoraphobia, they need to have a companion nearby. They need benzodiazepines, even if they have the pill bottle in their pocket with them. That still is a safety behavior, still an anxiety-reducing behavior. Going to the emergency room whenever you have a panic attack. Seeking information about, what does it mean if my heart's beating, 120 times a minute. These behaviors are functioning to reduce anxiety the same way that compulsive rituals reduce anxiety. In social phobia, we have excessive rehearsal to make sure that I'm going to say things correctly. Avoidance behavior, like we see in the other anxiety disorders, even alcohol use to loosen you up and so you're not worried about going to the party. These, again, serve to reduce anxiety. And in phobias, of course, we have avoidance and asking people for reassurance. Mommy, is there going to be a dog there? Is the dog going to bite me? And checking behavior, checking the weather channel to make sure there are no tornadoes or thunderstorms out today if you have a fear of storms. So is OCD an anxiety disorder? I absolutely think so. So moving on to issue number two, what about agoraphobia? Can it exist without a panic disorder? So first of all, this is the proposed diagnostic criteria for agoraphobia as a separate codable condition. You got to have marked fear or anxiety about more than one situation from this characteristic cluster of agoraphobic situations, right? So being outside the home by yourself, going on public transportation, open spaces, being in shops or theaters or waiting in line, being in a crowd. And the person has to fear or avoid these situations because escape might be difficult or they might not be able to get help if they're, in a large crowd. And the agoraphobic situation has to invariably provoke immediate fear or anxiety, and the person is avoiding them, or they require the presence of a companion to be with them. So let's step back. Let's take a look at a model of the phenomenology. What's going on in panic disorder? David Barlow, David Clark, other folks like that have done a lot of work to elucidate this empirically substantiated model, essentially showing that predisposing factors in longitudinal studies, again, work by David Barlow, David Clark, as well as Brad Schmidt, have found that when a person has the fear of fear, which we call anxiety sensitivity, essentially they're afraid of their body sensations that are associated with anxious arousal, that rapid heart rate, trouble catching your breath, feelings of dizziness. And when people are very hypervigilant to those kinds of sensations, then they're more likely to develop panic disorder. And so when an innocuous body sensation comes along, which inevitably it does, like heart palpitations, shortness of breath, even though it may be completely innocuous, the person's going to catastrophically misappraise these symptoms as, oh my God, I'm having a heart attack. Oh no, I'm suffocating. I'm gonna faint. And that, of course, activates the fight or flight response. That's a perception of threat. And that makes the person anxious, but more importantly, makes them have more body sensations, which become misinterpreted. And at the very moment that the person's worried about, you know, dying or having a heart attack, more symptoms appear that seem to confirm what's going on. So they, you know, oh no, things are getting worse, it's really happening. More fight or flight, and we get into this vicious cycle of a panic attack. And what does the person do to try to cope with the panic attack? Well, they use what we often call safety behaviors, right? So I'm gonna avoid situations like agoraphobia. I'm gonna avoid a situation where I've had that panic attack before. I'm gonna do whatever I can to escape. I'm gonna get out of there. I'm gonna use benzodiazepine medication, take that Xanax and make me feel better in a half hour or so. I might distract myself. So all these kinds of behaviors serve as ways to cope with panic disorder. Let's talk about agoraphobia. What's the nature of agoraphobia? Agoraphobic avoidance is clearly, research has shown, motivated by the fear of panic, not by the fear of the situations themselves. And people with agoraphobia consistently, this has been known for, you know, a long time, consistently report that their agoraphobia develops in response to their fear of having another panic attack. If I had a panic attack when I was driving by myself, I'm not getting into my car again because I don't want to have another panic attack. And usually folks who develop panic disorder, they're not really psychologically savvy. They don't understand that all the arrows that I showed you, they just think that, you know, it's associated with driving or associated with being in a crowd. And if something terrible happens, I won't be able to get help. And so lots of research has shown, again, that the vast majority of people say that, yeah, the agoraphobic is related to panic. It developed after I started having these panic attacks. Goldstein and Chambliss have done a lot of the great work on the phenomenology of agoraphobia, and kind of to summarize several studies that they conducted in the 70s and 80s, agoraphobic situations develop when a person has a panic attack and then associates the panic and anxiety with the situation itself. And they become hypervigilant to body sensations, very tuned in to what's going on in their body, and that can motivate the spread of agoraphobia to more and more situations. Oh, you know, I noticed my heart racing a lot when I was by myself at home. I can't let myself do that anymore. You have to stay at home with me. Or when I was on the train, I started to notice, you know, my heart racing. And what if I had a panic attack on the train? Then I wouldn't be able to get help because it's 2 hours till the next station, so I can't go on a train anymore. So the thing, though, is that agoraphobia, just like in OCD, like we saw, agoraphobia is just one strategy that people with panic use to cope with their panic symptoms and their fear of things like medical emergencies. So what are the different behavioral features of panic? Well, agoraphobic avoidance is one. And in fact, I would argue that here again, that's the most observable thing. That's the one that stands out the most. So that's what gets the attention in the DSM. But you don't read in the DSM anything about interoceptive avoidance, where the person's avoiding exercise, caffeine, even having sex, which elevates heart rate. You don't hear about distraction. People with panic avoid changing certain activities, watching TV, turning the radio up, or conversing. I'm sorry, they do those things to try to distract themselves when they notice themselves having what might be the beginning of a panic attack. And they engage in other kinds of safety behaviors, having a companion, a safe person,